I'm Jenny Gray. I'm the Chief Executive Officer at Zoos Victoria. Quick question. Who knows what is the bird emblem of Victoria? Yeah, you've all visited us here at Healesville Sanctuary and met the helmeted honeyeater in this tailor-made aviary where we have two of the most endangered birds, the helmeted honeyeater and the orange-bellied parrots. But today, I'm going to share with you some of the amazing work that's happening behind the scenes. I've come to the back of Healesville Sanctuary. Nestled down in some of this beautiful native bushland is where we have our endangered species breeding area. It's an area very few people are able to come to because we need to keep it super quiet. We need to make sure that when we're in this area, we're really respectful because this is where we breed the most endangered species. Today behind me, you can see the helmeted honeyeater aviaries. And this is where Megan and the team are breeding the most endangered helmeted honeyeaters.
So the helmeted honeyeater is not as well known as it should be, considering it is the Victorian bird emblem. And something really special that is happening this year is it's actually celebrating the 50th year of being our bird emblem here in Victoria, which is, yeah, really cool. And yeah, it's a species that I think not a lot of Victorians know about, and they really should, because the specialist thing about the helmeted honeyeater is it's the only bird species that's endemic to Victoria, meaning the only bird species that's unique to us.
So they're quite a small bird.
Tiny, so on average they weigh only about 30 grams.
So 30 grams, 6 spoons of sugar.
is that perhaps? For such a small animal, they pack such a personality. Out in the wild, they maintain territory, so they are quite aggressive. And we really see those personalities shine through here, even at Healesville Sanctuary in our breeding program.
So let's talk a little bit more about why do we place so much attention on them? They are a critically endangered species. And what is the challenge that's happened for our helmeted honeyeaters?
So unfortunately, they are listed as critically endangered with less than 240 individuals now remaining in the wild. Previously, there used to be more heavily distributed across from Healesville throughout to South Gippsland areas. So their distribution used to be a lot bigger. Throughout the 20th century, unfortunately, though, a lot of their habitat was lost from the effects of land clearing for agriculture, and they're now left in one single location known as Yellingberg Conservation Nature Conservation Reserve, which is about 50 k's east of Melbourne and is only about just over 600 hectares in size. So here at Healesville Sanctuary, we've been maintaining a captive breeding population as an insurance, but as well as a supplement to our wild animals. We're in our 32nd year now, so it's been one of the longest standing programs that Zoos Victoria has been involved in, which is another part that is quite special in that Zoos Victoria has been involved since the inception of the recovery team back in 1989, when there was less than 50 birds left out in the wild, and we jumped on board and have been playing a really major role as part of that conservation since then.
So every year we have a captive group of birds that breed up, they raise their young, and you've done all kinds of interesting strategies to maximize or increase the number of offspring each year. And then you take that deep breath and release them back in the wild. That must be quite fraught.
Yeah, actually.
Quite satisfying as well.
It's a bit of mixed emotions sometimes. You know, a large part of our job, the breeding season is quite long, so we're busy from August all the way through to March, making sure we do everything to get these birds paired up genetically, to make sure they get along, to monitor their nests. Yeah, we spend a lot of time watching them and being quite invested in their outcome. So it's one of those really bittersweet moments, which I'm sure parents who have kids can relate really well, in that you're really happy to see them go out into the wild, but a little part of you is like, oh, I'm losing those babies. But that's the biggest joy of this job. And I still, to this day, remember the first release that I was able to go and be a part of. And yeah, it was just this real wow feeling when you got to sit back and go, yeah, this is it. This is what we're doing. This is why we're here.
I love that as well, that moment you let them go. The fact they have so much personality means you've also been able to do work getting them ready for release.
Yeah, so we have a great new flocking facility where we're able to put all our juveniles together. So they grow up really quick. They're independent from their parents within 40 days of hatching. So
there's parents at home going 40
some
days.
Some people might be
wow.
getting a little jealous there, but yeah, really, really quick out of the nest. So even though they are quite territorial, they are a really social bird. So you will see that corroboree behavior where they flutter those wings and it's that nice, cute, shrill call and they're saying, hey, how are you going? Oh, it's good to see you. So it's a bit of a social gathering and greeting to each other. And we do see that when we release them out into the wild.
And talking about helmeted honeyeaters, we have to talk about the friends of the helmeted honeyeater. How amazing are the friends of the helmeted honeyeater?
Mind-blowingly amazing. I think that
off the scale amazing.
I think that was one of the biggest realizations and joy being more. The more I've been involved in this program is seeing the amount of different partnerships that have been a part of this history for the last 32 years, and the amount of work that's been put in to really rally behind this bird and make a real difference. And yeah, the passion and time and energy and effort that these groups show towards saving the helmeted honeyeater is just really, yeah, inspiring. And it makes you sit back and go, wow, like I'm just doing a really small part here. These guys are, they're the real deal.
Saving a species needs so many partners, and the helmeted honeyeater is just a really great example of that. We know habitat is where the success is going to be, and so the friends are really active both in watching the birds and making sure they're all right, but also in planting habitat and making sure every year we have a bigger and bigger area full of flowering plants for these little guys to thrive on. Now, Megan, I have one last question, because I know there's people watching this who are going to say, I have helmeted honeyeaters in my backyard.
Whenever anyone asks that question or says that they might have seen one, I mean, it's great. They know about the animal. They want to be engaged about the animal. But unfortunately, it's most likely not the helmeted honeyeater, but a really closely related subspecies known as the yellow-tufted honeyeater. And it takes quite a trained eye to sort of tell the difference between the two. But you're looking for a bit of a sort of mohawk on the side of the helmeted honeyeater's head. So that's where that name, helmet, comes from.
If you're confused by that, you're not alone. I will not say that I could tell the difference. The helmeted is our state emblem, and I think it's only appropriate that we put this extra energy in. I'm excited to celebrate the 50 years of helmeted honeyeaters, and thank you for all the incredible work you're doing, Megan.
No worries, my pleasure.
Behind me is the flocking aviary that Megan talked about. And right now we have a whole lot of the season's juveniles meeting friends, getting to know the cohort that they're going to be released with back into the wild in the coming spring. But it's only possible because of the incredible support we get from our members, from visitors, and from amazing donors. Together we can make a difference for the bird emblem of Victoria. We can make sure that children well into the future get to know the critically endangered helmeted honeyeater. And hopefully it won't be critically endangered by then.